All right. I think that we are live. And so I'm going to say hello to everybody out there. Hi from Split This Rock. And welcome to tonight's event, The Future Lives in Our Bodies, a Poetry and Disability Justice Roundtable featuring the incredible Meg Day, Naomi Ortiz, and Leah Lakshmi Piepzna-Samarasinha. I'm so glad everyone's joining us here digitally, and I think tonight's going to be a power-packed event where there's just going to be so much joy and wisdom to impart. I hope you leave with what you were hoping for and even beyond that. My name is Camisha Jones. I am Split This Rock's Managing Director, and I'll be serving as tonight's moderator. For access, everyone tonight will be offering a visual description, and I'll get us started. I'm a brown-skinned Black cis woman. My natural textured hair is worn in a short tapered cut, which is currently styled with tight curls and some light purple dye. I'm wearing a Black and white striped shirt and dangling Black earrings. Behind me is a white wall with two Black and white framed photos and a filled bookcase to my right. Behind me are candles, a plant, a lamp, and photos of my mom and grandmother that sit on top of a chest that was my grandmother's. Also, to help ensure that everyone can experience the roundtable as fully as possible, we have an ASL interpreter, thanks Emily, and live captioning, thanks Max. A direct link to the captions will be available via our social media platforms and within the description for this event on YouTube. We'll aim to verbally identify who's speaking throughout the program, and a video of this event will be available on YouTube after it's properly captioned. For those unfamiliar with Split This Rock, we are a nonprofit founded in 2008 that's committed to cultivating, teaching, and celebrating poetry that bears witness to injustice and provokes change. We have been in a fallow season to better align the organization's work with its values, disability justice principles, as outlined by Sons and Valor, being a big part of those values we're working to center. We return to public programming next month and look forward to gathering with you virtually for other events on the horizon. Split This Rock is located in the unceded land of the Piscataway and near the ancestral homes of Powhatan, Pamunkey, Chickahominy, Monacan, and other Native nations. We acknowledge Black ancestors who built what we now know as DC. We pause to acknowledge these ancestors and their descendants respectfully to bring attention to erasure within the telling of US history, believing it is critically important to remember this country's history of stolen land and labor in order to take effective action towards liberation for all. This event is presented in support of the 6th annual initiative of the Poetry Coalition. The Poetry Coalition is a national alliance of nearly 30 independent poetry organizations, including Split This Rock, that are dedicated to working together to promote the value poets bring to our culture and the important contribution poetry makes in the lives of people of all ages and backgrounds. Poetry Coalition programming is made possible in part by grants from the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation and the Ford Foundation, which was secured by the Academy of American Poets. Now I get to introduce these amazing poets who'll be sharing their thoughts and ideas for the future with us tonight. Each of the poets with us today has taught me something that's been critical to my understanding of disability justice. Each of them is someone I respect and admire and aspire in my own way to be a similar force for making disability justice a reality in the here and now. First up is Meg Day. Deaf, genderqueer poet Meg Day is the author of Last Psalm at Sea Level, published by Barrel Street in 2014. It's the winner of Publishing Triangle's Audre Lorde Award. A recipient of the Amy Lowell Poetry Traveling Scholarship and an NEA Fellowship in Poetry, Day's recent work can be found in Best American Poetry 2020 and the New York Times. Meg and I were part of the new Disability Poetics Symposium at the University of Pennsylvania in, I believe, 2008. And their keynote still shakes me in the best possible way, waking me up to the possibilities when disabled lives are centered and not just accommodated. I also had the great privilege of sitting in on one of Meg's classes, and I have to say Meg is a brilliant educator. And I'm sure there'll be some education tonight. Hi, Meg, please say hello to everyone, offer your pronouns and a visual description.
Hi, my name is Meg Day. I use they, them pronouns. My visual description is I'm a white, transmasculine, genderqueer person with short, blonde hair and dark button down. I'm wearing hearing aids and sitting in front of a window. This is my name sign. And I'm signing in from unceded Susquehannock land in South Central Pennsylvania.
Thank you, Meg. Now, Naomi Ortiz. Naomi is a poet, writer, facilitator, and visual artist whose intersectional work focuses on self-care for activists, disability justice, climate action, and relationship to place. Ortiz is the author of Sustaining Spirit, Self-Care for Social Justice, a nonfiction book exploring self-care tools and strategies for diverse communities. Ortiz is a Zooglossia Poetry Fellow whose poems have been nominated for Best of the Internet, listed on Entropy's Best of 2021 Favorite Poems Published Online, and appear in a variety of publications, anthologies, and performances. Ortiz is a disabled mestiza living in the Arizona, US-Mexico borderlands. Naomi and I are co-editing an anthology of disability poetry with Travis Lau and Michael Northern. Whether it's within the editorial process or running a workshop like the one she led for Split This Rock in 2021, I've learned so much from Naomi about holding space in ways that honor the body and center intersectionality, access, and compassion. I've been so grateful for opportunities to partner with her and to bring her wisdom to you tonight. Hi, Naomi. Say hello to everybody.
Hello, everyone. My name is Naomi Ortiz, and such a beautiful thank you for that intro, Camisha. It's a privilege to be working with you too on our cool, very amazing anthology that's going to be coming that has Meg Day and Leah in it. So I use they, she pronouns, and I'm located in Tucson on the current and ancestral lands of the Pascua, or of the Atham, and the current settlement of the Pascua-Yaqui tribe of Arizona. I am a light-skinned mestizax, and I have hoop earrings on and a necklace from my mother, and I'm wearing a print dress and a black bolero, and I'm sitting in a space with some art and books and light green walls.
Thank you, Naomi. Last up, we have Leah Lakshmi Piepzna-Samarasinha, who uses she, they pronouns. Leah is a queer, disabled, non-binary femme writer, poet, disability and transformative justice movement worker, and educator of Berber Tamil, Sri Lankan and Irish, and Galician Roma ascent. They are the author or co-editor of 10 books, including with Ajiris Dixon, Beyond Survival, Strategies and Stories from the Transformative Justice Movement, Tongue Breaker, Bridge of Flowers, Care Work, Dreaming Disability Justice, and Body Map. A Lambda Award winner who has been shortlisted for the Publishing Triangle 5 times, she is winner of Lambda's 2020 Jean Cordova Award, honoring a lifetime of work documenting the complexities of queer, of color, disabled femme experience, and is a 2020 to 2021 Disabilities Futures Fellow. Since 2009, they have been a lead performer with Disability Justice Performance Collective Sons in Valley. Since 2020, they have been on the programming team of the Disability and Intersectionality Summit. Raised in Rust Belt, Central Massachusetts, and shaped by Toronto and Oakland, they are a hot, haggard porch and couch witch and a very unprofessional adaptive trike rider. Their 10th book, which we're all excited for, The Future is Disabled, Prophecies, Love Notes, and Mourning Songs, is forthcoming in the fall of 2022. I also want to add to Leah's bio that the line, "The future lives in our bodies," within this year's Poetry Coalition theme is from Leah's poem, Femme Futures. I'm thrilled to have Leah with us, given her words are the inspiration of this year's Poetry Coalition programming. One way that Leah's really impacted me, and it might seem kind of small thing, but it was big for me. Leah was one of the featured poets scheduled to be part of Split This Rock's 2020 festival. And as I was requesting things from Leah, she sent me a document, a rider, I believe. And a big part of that rider was communicating accessibility standards that needed to be in place for her participation. It opened me up and emboldened me to new levels of access advocacy, not just for myself, but for others when I'm invited to be part of events. Also, Leah's book, Care Work, has equipped me with an understanding of CRIP models of leadership, which has been so empowering. Leah, say hello to everybody.
Hi, I'm Leah. I'm just this guy. I'm a 47-year-old mixed race, light skinned, non-binary femme. I just got my hair cut this morning. Sika at Salon 261 in Northampton. She's great. I've got curly, kind of graying purple brown hair on one side of my head, and I've got a fade on the other. Rose gold aviator glasses, and my lipstick is Heroin with an E by MAC. Which I got for free because they're on the BDS list. So yeah, if you can scam it, you can get it. And I'm wearing this kind of one-shouldered rose gold top and this necklace by this fisting necklace, which has a little queer hand on a pink triangle and a black glove, which is by Wild Fancy by my friends Lex and Vula. And I forget what else I'm supposed to say. Hold on, I wrote this down. It's coming to you from unceded Pecumtuck territory in Western Massachusetts. And behind me is this very Massachusetts, like, fake wood paneling situation. Like, it's really, the landlady was like, it hasn't really been renovated since the 80s. And I was like, yeah, the rent is also from the 80s. So that part's good. And just really excited to be here.
Thanks, everybody. So let's get into this. I have an invitation for framing our time together first. So knowing so much related to the contributions of disabled innovators and leaders has often been erased. I'd like to start us off by asking who or what we need to name in this space as an act of resistance against erasure. I invite each of you to name someone or something that holds light for this conversation.
This is Naomi. I'd like to invite in Marlon Thomas, who was a friend of mine and an amazing poet. He would have loved this event so much. He and I performed at the Disability Pride Parade, the inaugural one in 2005 in Chicago, long time ago. And he has a book of poetry that was published after his death, called Special Ed is Down the Hall. So I want to invite him in.
Thanks, Naomi. Who'd like to go next? Okay, Meg.
I want to invite in our elder, Laura Hershey, who is keeping good company these days as I take up new understandings of consent and desire and resist all patternings encouraged by capitalism and ableism and transphobia and being accountable to white supremacy. I'm so grateful for her life, and I welcome her in.
Thank you. Leah, Would you like to?
Yeah, I always want to welcome in my friend, sibling, and comrade, Stacey Park Milburn, who died 2 years ago on her birthday, May 19th, 2020, who a lot of people know as the phenomenal vanguard disability justice organizer she was, but who started as a poet and ended as a poet, and is still a poet, and who I met as a poet. I want to call her in. I want to call in... You know, like we have at least 6 million people who've died of COVID in the past 2 years that we know of, and a lot of those people are disabled poets. So I want to call them in, the ones we know, the ones we don't. And sorry, I'm always like, I feel like my, you know, my gravestone is going to say one more thing. But I want to call in the disabled cutie BIPOC poets who... like Tatiana de la Tierra, you know, fat Colombian femme writer, Audre Lorde, Essex Hemphill, who absolutely wrote out of disabled Black and Brown experiences and who may or may not have used the D word, but were doing disability justice before disability justice was a word. Check.
Yes, thank you so much. I feel their presence, all of them. Thank you. This is Camisha. Before we get into media conversation, I'm also aware that not everybody tuning in today has the same level of understanding about what disability justice even is. So I know it's a tall order, but I'd like to offer space for each of you to give a brief description of what you mean when you refer to disability justice. And I know Naomi and Leah, you've been doing this work for a very long time, even before the term itself became a thing, right along with as it was becoming a thing. So if you want to talk about some of those experiences out of framing, you're welcome. Who would like to go first?
We're pointing at each other. This is Leah. I can go. So I just want to name it disability justice as a term. If you want to know in detail what it is, you can look up Sins and Valids, 10 Principles of Disability Justice. And there's a link in the access copy that I dropped in to a bunch of different variations of the 10 principles. But disability justice was invented in 2005 by a small group of Black, Asian, and working class and poor white queer and trans disabled organizers and thinkers who were really sitting in what Patricia Byrne, who's one of the thought leaders of disability justice, calls the cliffhangers of the disability rights movement around, like, yeah, we're, you know, really glad that the ADA exists and that legal frameworks exist, but what we're not feeling served by is the ways in which disability rights has become a white, cis, male, single issue paradigm that's really only relying on laws a lot of the time. So it's important for me to say that that's how it was invented, that it's an anti-capitalist framework, it is an anti-colonial framework, it's a framework that is about... it's about, like, you know, as Subcomandante Marcos of the EZLN said, walking, we ask questions. It's about us figuring out this path forward to freedom together. I would say, you know, that's not in the 10 principles, but I would say it. And it's not just the new word, because I've heard people say, oh, DJ, that's what we're saying now. We used to say disability rights. And I'm like, no, it's overlapping and it's different. Right. And as Sins and Valids said, like, we are a movement building framework. We're not an academic theory. It's something that centers the lives and leadership of disabled Black and Brown people, of disabled queer and gender nonconforming people. And if you don't have that, you don't have disability justice. Yeah, I think that's my short version. I'll stop there.
This is Camisha. Thank you, Leah. Naomi.
This is Naomi. That was super succinct. Thanks, Leah. Really well put.
I'll just once in a while I can pull off succinct, not often. This is Leah. Sorry, I'll shut up.
I'll just add, so in the late, there's a kind of chunk of history that seems just not to be documented very well before sort of the really the it was really on the cusp of social media and a lot of what we understand the world to be now. So in the late 1990s and 2000s, there was a lot of funding actually for youth organizing, youth disabled organizing across the country. And so those of us who got involved at the time were doing really amazing stuff, often by conference call. trying to, you know, like put out a different kind of vision into the world that included young folks and pushing the boundaries of what disability rights was. And we heard, you know, not knowing where all this came from, of course, like we heard this term disability justice being used in adult disability organizations in the place of disability rights. And we're like, I don't think this, that does, that just doesn't feel right. And so a group of us got together to just sort of dream and think deeply about what the next wave of disability organizing could look like, what it means, you know, how could it be bigger than just disability rights? Because disability rights is still needed, very much so. But, you know, it's like, what more could there be? And I think one thing I really carry from those conversations, we did post the notes online, if you're interested, from that meeting, is that it's not just what you have a right to, it's what you're responsible for. And I think that this was a shift at that time between, you know, like everybody feeling like they were facing a level of oppression that required a lot of advocacy and rights, which it did exist, but it's also bringing in that we also had privilege in that situation. And how could we use that privilege, whether we're an adult, whether we speak English, whether we're, you know, all the privileges that we carry with us, how do we leverage that privilege to create more opportunities for all of us? So leveraging it for solidarity. So not just what we have a right to, but what we're responsible for.
Thank you, Naomi. Meg, is there anything you want to add?
Sure, this is Meg speaking. I came to my own lived understanding of disability justice through poetry, through people and poetry. I came up under deaf poets signing in ASL and was lucky to be welcomed as a participant in workshops with Sins Invalid and to get raised proper under the work of folks like Leah and Patty and Leroy. And through early interactions also with ADAPT and ACT UP, which are not what I would call disability justice organizations, but rather cohorts that sort of enact disability justice on occasion, sometimes on purpose and sometimes not. I understand disability justice to be a promise. That promise moves beyond, as Naomi's saying, basic rights and reminds me that excess is not enough, that excess is often rather insulting sometimes as a barometer of what it is that we deserve. And in the same way, or maybe in a similar way, that there's a difference between equality and equity, between freedom and liberation, there's a difference between rights and justice. Rights are not necessarily intersectional. They prioritize the individual, which means they prioritize capitalism and make interdependence not only difficult, but distasteful, maybe. Rights tend to be a reduction of how to begin making up for the fact of an ableist culture. It's a way to make us like them, which reiterates a false binary of us and them. So disability justice for me has been about collective liberation and about community, about being accountable and learning from folks who have gone before, and primarily Black and Brown folks. It's both he and it's speculative. It's both living and being made and not yet made. It's a promise. It's one we make. And it's one we're keeping. So.
This is Camisha. Yes. It's a promise. Next question. How have you witnessed disability justice being done well in the poetry or artistic world? What made it good? And bonus points if you can name something that's happened within the ongoing pandemic. Should I take the silence to mean you have not seen anything?
I can. This is Leah. I can go. It's complicated. I mean, I think that, like, no, I've seen stuff, but I guess this is the thing. Like, I think, Camisha, when you say the poetry world, right, that can mean so many things. But I guess hearing that, it just makes me feel how, and I've got more access than a lot of people, but I just feel like I'm not part of the poetry world. You know, I feel like sometimes I am, and I feel like some people in that world maybe know who we are. But I just feel like I live in disabled / deaf, sometimes overlapping poetry world. And a lot of the rest of the capital P poetry world does not know or give a shit, you know? So have I seen disability justice done well in creative spaces? Yeah. One thing, you know, after I did my like 101, like it was started in 2005 and it's Black and Brown and get it right thing. And then I was listening to Naomi and Meg, you speaking much more eloquently and beautifully, I was just like, oh, the thing I left out is that's important is that, and it's interesting is that I think that, well, the place that I connected with disability justice was through performance art, was through Sins and Ballad, was through sneaking out to go to their show in 2008 and not telling anybody in the very able-bodied queer and trans people of color performance art scene I was a part of in Oakland because I was closeted as a disabled person, right? And I didn't know anyone. I was like, oh, no one's going to want to go to the cripple show with me. That's not fun. And then I was like, whoa. And I've written about this. I was like, it's not just what was on the stage. It's that the whole space was a temporary liberated zone of cross disabled, like not just access, but disabled and deaf pleasure and flirtation and communication and community. Right? Where it's not just like, oh, I guess we'll give you one shitty wheelchair accessible seat and like bad interpretation, but there's just this richness. And I was like, oh, I could actually maybe talk about this whole part of my life that I'm lying about. Right? And as June Jordan said, you can't write lies and write good poetry. So that's important. So, I mean, in Sins, yeah, in I Want to Be With You Everywhere, which was a show I was part of, like a 3-day festival in New York that Camisha was part of too, like absolutely. And, you know, in a lot of different disabled and deaf poetic spaces, sure. And even I'm thinking about Unapologetic Burlesque, which was a cutie POC, queer and trans BIPOC, burlesque and dance performance series in Toronto, where, like, this is back in 07, and they had everything captioned. They had ASL, like, everything was audio described. They had greeters, and they were doing this on no money, you know, out of a lot of care. Like, absolutely. And then, yes, during the pandemic, I think that it was just part of this cripping of the world that's happened and deafing where, you know, all the normal abled hearing people were like, oh, fuck, we're on Zoom. I guess we should listen to these other people and figure out what CART is. And, oh, finally, there's an ASL budget sometimes. Holy shit. And like every TERP is getting booked up for badly organized work a lot of the time, you know. And so, like, yeah, I've seen it. And also I've seen it. The abled will and the hearing will do anything to forget about disability and deafness. So, you know, and this might be jumping ahead, but we're 2 years in and there is this like, well, that was weird. Thank God we can go cough on each other or bullshit. And it's really horrible because I'm like, we know everything can be different because it was like you were always saying that there was no money for it and you didn't know how to do it. I mean, I will always talk about going to the American Studies Association and or not going because I, you know, had all my joints were thrown out. And I was like, I can't get on a plane. Can we do Zoom? And they were like, what is Zoom? I don't know if we can do Zoom. That's high technology. I'm like, you're in a Hilton. You can do Zoom. And then Crips brought a projector and did it because of course they did. And they were like, well, we don't know about that. And then, you know, 2 months later, of course, everyone's doing Zoom. I just feel like simultaneously incredibly hopeful and incredibly cynical. But disabled and deaf spaces are deep pleasure, so why wouldn't you want to do it? That's what I got.
Meg, what you got?
This is Meg. I was also at that Sins and Valid show in 2008. I saw Leah, you look good. And I remember being there and thinking like, oh shit, right? Like this is when everything and I don't even know what the term is, goes right. When everyone is anticipated, when the space is primed, I don't even have like good like English language for how to describe what it's like to be in a room where perhaps non-disabled folks would feel aware of things that for deaf and disabled folks, suddenly everything clicks. And it's not that I haven't experienced that elsewhere. It's that I haven't ever experienced it on that scale. I think that, you know, like I've been to like Mangos with Tilly's shows, or I've been to the Flying Words Project. You know, I've been to places where like everything is accessible and everything's like exciting and hot and there's representation and, you know, things are working on multiple cylinders, if that makes sense, right? Like it's not just, there's no tokenization necessarily, and access isn't the thing that we're just like thanking them for all night. Like, oh, thank you, thank you, thank you that like the interpreter was booked for the whole time and not just the first hour. And the interpreter is not a student and the interpreter is not related to, you know, the organizer for, you know how things can go. And so it's really not that it doesn't happen. It's just that it's so rare. And then to have it be something that's like so large scale like that, I think Sins Invalid is really, for me, the barometer, right? Like, and I've never been in another space like that, which is perhaps, I don't know, perhaps that's a good thing. Like maybe each space needs to remake itself. During the pandemic that is ongoing, I've done a lot of work with different organizations, as I know other people in this call meeting cohort have, around like how to improve their access and how to understand disability justice as an organization, and like teaching people, you know, DIS 101 type things. And very few of them, I feel, have pursued an ongoing relationship with that conversation. One exception, which I'm happy to shout them out, is Open Mouth Reading Series in Fayetteville, Arkansas. They've got their shit together, y'all. They hired a bunch of different deaf and disabled people throughout the pandemic to come and teach their organizing crew, like how to do things, how to anticipate folks, how to market to them, how to make sure that we know about events that are happening and that the interpreters are funded and they take, you know, non-disabled people's money to provide. And it's amazing. So there are things that are happening, but again, I don't really know that that's like what I would hold up as, you know, like that's solid allyship. I don't know that I would call that disability justice in the way that we're speaking about or in the way that we envision, right? Like what is the speculative dream? Like what is, like I get a little giddy thinking of it, like what we could have. And we're so hung up on like, yeah, I'm grateful that, you know, for the captioner and for the interpreter and like, yes, we need you, please don't go anywhere. But also like, could we keep our clothes on about it? Like, I just don't want to hand out the trophies quite yet. So that kind of engagement I think is missing. And I know that much of it has to do with folks not understanding what joy is possible and what hotness is possible and what like creative brilliance is possible. Brilliance like in the glistening kind. But I think if you knew, you wouldn't want anything else. Like I think about that show at Sins. I mean, it was 2008 and then again in 2010, right? Oof, I dream about that shit. So I don't know that I have anything to compare to.
So well put. This is Naomi. I just wanted to throw in a different example. And I really appreciate, I've been excited to see, you know, more organizations like Split This Rock. Like, you know, I was part of a Poetry Foundation event moderating, and they had interpreters and caption, and that was great. I think a lot of times people think about access as comfort versus like literally being able to participate or not participate. And that's super challenging because it's like, I think people think they're doing disability justice when we can like literally get in the door and, or like, you know, the virtual door to participate. And these are such beautiful examples about, no, disability justice is an embracement of disability culture, which looks so different. And I just want to give a shout out. I've been to a few different disability pride parades in Chicago. They happen around the world. And that for me was one of my first experiences of like really being in solid Crip culture, you know, where like an expectation of difference, there was just an expectation of difference, period. And things weren't perfect and everybody was like figuring it out the entire time. And it was beautiful. So just add my two cents in.
This is Leah. Is it okay if I add on something to the question? If I keep it quick. No, I mean, Meg, I'm also asking you if that's okay. I bogart a little bit. Okay. Just like, I guess, just what y'all are saying about like, it's not just about access, it's about joy and culture. Like, I guess some specific things I want to throw out that are dynamics are, I do want to say that I see, I mean, kind of Meg, like what you were saying of, and know me too, about like the Disabled Pride Parade and like the Fayetteville group, where it's people who don't have all the money in the world, but who are making choices about, yeah, like this is just something we're going to do. And I do see some organizations, like I do want to shout out Asian American Writers Workshop, who even back in 2018, when I was on Care Work Tour, were like, yeah, you know, we can live stream this. We can get an interpreter. It's wheelchair accessible. And I was like, amazing. See, it's possible. And then I also am thinking about like, ironically, and I'm not trying to shit where I eat, but you know, though I might be anyway, but with, you know, the whole Poetry Foundation, the Future Lives in Our Bodies thing, it was interesting doing that work because I was like, when they approached me, I was like, yes. And then I was like, will you insist that everybody who does an event with this theme has access? And we had to have that conversation, and they're like, oh, good. And they're like, yeah. And I was like, okay, do you know what that means? Because, and you might, but not all of them do. So you have to send out this thing that's like, here's what ASL is. Here's what CART is. Here's like, cause I'm like, I just was like, are they, I had this nightmare moment where I was like, are they going to have events where it's in person with no ramp and no, you know, no nothing. And that's always possible, right? Like, I mean, I've seen that as disability justice hits like year 17 of the word being around, where you do see people just putting a bird on it. And then I'm just like, but there's not actually any disabled or deaf people in this thing, you know, or in leadership. So actually, no. And then last thing I want to say, and it's like small, and this might be actually no, like, well, no, you know what? I'll hold off because I think that could be something that speaks to a question that's later on. But I just want to say, like, people have good intentions, and then it's that lack of like fully engagement where they're like, great, we did the workshop. And I'm like, no, but you have to change everything forever. You have to change everything forever. And then you have to keep changing it.
Yes, I love that. Forever. Let's go with the next question. So, what's at stake without disability justice as a framework? How have you noticed those risks manifesting themselves?
This is Leah. We die and we get forgotten and erased. It's pretty simple. I mean, I think specifically in this pandemic moment in time, if there's no DJ, well, and it's more than that. I mean, without DJ, then you have like a small number of disabled writers that are white, right? Like again, when Poetry Foundation was like, can you curate an anthology of disability justice poetics? I looked and they were like, we'd love it if you could use stuff that's in our database already, because otherwise we have to get permissions. And I was like, so, and I'm like, it's not just you, but you don't have disability as a searchable term. Like you have the body and illness, you know, and like, that's it. And then I was like, I'm looking and I'm like, you know, you've got Laura, who I love, and you've got a handful of white disabled writers. And so I was like, I'm sorry, but you're gonna have to up the budget because you're gonna have to go get permissions because the writers I wanna have in here are disabled BIPOC that are not in the database, or their poems aren't in the database. So you gotta go find them, right? And in some cases it was tricky. Like there was a couple people where they're dead and we couldn't find the permissions, and you know, and also tricky things where like sometimes people are dead and you might be able to get the permissions, but then sometimes you're wrestling with an estate that's like, she wasn't that, you know, which didn't happen, but like that's always an issue, right? So I think I think it's really recently because of our work that it's been a bit easier. And it's not that there haven't been disabled BIPOC poets. Of course there fucking have been. And I really want to shout out people who, Naomi, kind of like when you were talking about like those youth gatherings, which I didn't know about, like, thank you for bringing that story to the space. That makes me think of things like, you know, one of the first scenes that was a written place that had what I would call disability justice writing was a zine called Scars Tell Stories that was edited by Quoley Driscoll and Colin Donovan back in the year like 2000, you know? And there are so many poets like Billy Rain, you know, like Quoley, like people who were doing this work 22 years ago who, you know, who some of whom who are still writing, but I'm just like, yeah, that's like the pre-MySpace generation. You know, it's not social media at all. And it was also a period of time where it's like, you know, it's not like, it's like we were below the pavement in terms of visibility, you know? And I know visibility is a trap, but like, there's also a reason why Alice Wong calls her project the Disability Visibility Project, because being able to find each other is really important. And we had like a couple zines, you know, and just real blatant ableism in social justice movement that was being challenged and still is, but was just like, oh yeah, racism, sexism, homophobia, classism, and other forms of oppression. And that's ableism and transphobia, you know? So yeah, I just think like I want there to be a richness and findability easily of disabled BIPOC and deaf BIPOC literature. And beyond that, I also want like all MFAs to be fully accessible, all residencies to be fully accessible. I want there to be a cripping and deafening of what having a successful career is, on and on and on. But also at this point, I'm like, I just don't want us to die because y'all are hell bent on having an in-person non-ventilated event again. Also. Because, you know, DJ helps everybody. I mean, even if you're abled, you don't want to get long COVID, right? Or, you know, I don't know.
This is Naomi. I think that one of the things that's at stake without display justice as a framework is that we will be caught in the seventh layer of, what is that thing? Where you're purgatory, where you just like go in one place around and around. About explaining what access is. you know, a couple of years ago, I counted up within like a 2-year span, how many organizations, farmers markets, museums, like events, festivals, I had offered access information to and training. And it was 41 entities within a couple of years. I was like hell bent on making my community accessible. And out of all of those, one event actually followed through on the access and has continued to follow through actually. It's the QTPOC Fest that's here in Tucson. But yeah, I mean, it's incredibly challenging to feel like we're just stuck in this like, this circle of like, let me explain what accessibility is and why it matters that we're there. and yes, you know, it might ruin your ambiance, but you know, you actually have then diversity. so disability justice to me is so much more, right? About, you know, dreaming together and learning from each other and real solidarity work, which as a disability community, I'm a little worried about us right now. You know, I think that, our spaces and our energy is going so hard towards survival, which it always is, but especially in this time of COVID, which we are still in the time of COVID. And so, you know, it's like, where are we finding joy? And to me, that's the key question. It's like, we need our disability joy. And that's what's at stake. And it's big.
And this is Meg. I want to lift up everything that has been said in terms of what's at stake and what the risks are. I was thinking as Leah was speaking of, I think it's a Hurston quote about how if you let them, they'll kill you and say you liked it. I think that that's the thing that's on my mind the most lately. Certainly joy, certainly survival, but then also the part where when we die, and we do die, and we have seen so much death in our community, not just during the pandemic, though certainly, but even in the years prior, the few years prior, just like massive amounts of loss. But thinking about the ways that we are honored, remembered, forgotten, archived, and the way that without disability justice as a framework to understand what it is that we've done with our time here, we are so reduced down to, oh gosh, I don't even know what, down to how capitalism defines us, which is often as nothing, is often as troublemakers, often as little blips in artistic communities. I'm thinking about like every New York Times obituary of queer Cripkin I've seen in the last 10 years and the ways that I've read it thinking, well, this is not factual. And yet it really misses sort of the nuances of what it means to be a change agent and an activist and invested in a framework that perhaps does not pander in the ways that we are asked to pander. I really don't want to be in that. I don't want to be on the tricycle in that cul-de-sac that Naomi is describing. I do not want to be around and around and around in circles on the access question for forever. But I really also don't want to be a part of a community that looks at me or looks at any of us who are invested in disability justice as if we are ruining it for the other dis and deaf folks who have finally, you know, clawed their way to rock bottom, which is what access, which is accommodations, which is being acknowledged as a part of the, you know, academy's like DEI strategic plan or whatever. So I'm really worried about that. I'm worried about living the rest of my days in conflict with the community that I do have, because I want something that either they can't fathom or don't feel permission to imagine because of what feels at stake for them. I think that there's such a scarcity model at play, and it makes us competitors with one another instead of comrades, interdependent comrades. And I see it everywhere. I see it in the academy. I see it outside of it. I see it, you know, at the local park. I see it everywhere. I want something different to be the future.
I do too. For everyone that was thinking about the Hurston quote that Meg mentioned, I was able to pull that up. It is, if you are silent about your pain, they'll kill you and say you enjoyed it. Pivoting to the next question, Leah, you've already kind of brought this up. So wanted to talk a little bit about the fact that there are lots of people eager to return to in-person programming. A lot of organizations already have. Given where we are in the ongoing pandemic, what would you say are some important things related to disability justice that the poetry community should keep in mind when considering a pivot to in-person events and gatherings?
Oh my. This is Naomi. I struggle with how to address this right now in my community. And, you know, what's been so liberating for me in this time has been access to all these virtual environments. And not having to use all this energy to figure out how to get there, how to get in the door. If I can get in the door, can I pee? You know, all these things. And just like literally being able to show up if I want to show up and not show up if I don't feel up to it. That's been pretty amazing. I think with going back to in-person, the thing I worry about a lot is like this, you know, pitch of like hybrid. That like, oh, well, we can still do stuff, but stream it online. And what happens is like the folks who are online in this virtual environment just get completely silenced and forgotten about because it's the people in the room, it's that power in the room that people are really attuned to. So one of the things that I just wanted to uplift is, you know, having a real role for folks in these virtual environments, keeping things virtual for a while longer, and maybe even forever, as Leo was saying. So I'm sure everybody else has something to say, so I'll stop.
This is Meg. Yeah, I want to lift up everything Naomi has said. I don't think that, you know, quitting Zoomlandia should be a part of our immediate mission in the way that it seems to have become. We seem just like so eager to be rid of both Zoom and masks, or at least in my community, that seems to be like to the top two priorities. Is like, we got to get rid of these things on our faces and we got to get off our computers. And once we do, everybody's going to be fine. And that's a funny lie to tell ourselves. And it's a dangerous one. One thing that I've been experimenting with my classes and with my local community here is prioritizing Zoom in the way that we used to prioritize in person. And so the event occurs on Zoom or whatever online platform. And if you would like to gather and breathe on one another and be in community in like whatever way, you know, that lens, please do. And we will even provide spaces for that to occur. And there will be guidelines and there will, you know, it will still be accessible and masks will still be, you know, required, if not strongly recommended, or it will be outdoors or whatever. But sort of shifting the paradigm and reversing that kind of hierarchy has done a lot of good. I think it's increased in the same way that we saw, you know, participation in many ways sort of skyrocket across the course of the first 2 years of the pandemic because we were online and folks could attend things internationally and in multiple languages and participate in ways that don't involve, you know, mustering up the courage in a chaotic space to finally say the thing that you want to say before the conversation changes. Yeah, I think just a lot has become more possible in this approach. I haven't been at it very long, but I think we're fools if we think that taking away online access is at all in tandem with the mission of like most nonprofits and most educational spaces. It's absolutely a lie. If you're removing those options, that's antithetical to what it is that you say that you're after. And that's just one aspect, right? There are so many other options and possibilities for what might be possible, but that's forefront on my mind.
This is Leah. I mean, I just want to add to what Naomi and Meg did, and Meg said. I think that like, another thing that disability justice is about for me is like keeping each other alive and looking out for each other. And that's, if you just go to like what the values are, like never, I mean, yes, also like the future we want, but also I'm like, how do I want to live my life? I'm about a community that's where the ways that we answer the question is, how are we keeping each other alive? Like, what are the choices in that? And I think that there's an enormous amount of disabled and deaf and autistic creativity that comes into play there, you know, and has throughout the pandemic. I mean, just to underline what you both said, I mean, I was like, yeah. I mean, Jerison, my book came out late January 2020. We both are, you know, chronically ill on the continuum, you know, and we did 3 live events before we were like, we gotta cancel this, you know, both because it wasn't safe for us, but we were like, this isn't, we cannot, we don't feel, it's not the responsible thing to do, speaking of responsibility, to bring together 200 people to like breathe on each other and die. So we're not gonna do that. And I know that we both were kind of like, shit, okay, we have a book that's out. We're trying to get it out there in the world. How do we do it? But then there, I just think of events we did online where I'm like, there's like 600 people here, you know, and that's into like 2021, 2022. And the richness, you know, as Meg, I think you were speaking to, of like the conversations and the questions that were had in chat. And as you know, as a neurodivergent person, like I was just like my first language is text. So, or my second, you know, like voice is third. And I was like, oh, I can actually not be just disassociated and uncomfortable and overwhelmed. I can actually, you know, bring my thoughts out with other people. And it's about not killing each other, but I think it's also about the richness of that and about like, wow, we can bring together masses of people in this way. And having said that, like, I don't think we're there yet at all, but like, I do also want to hold space for something that I heard Patty say around SINS like years ago before the pandemic, where she's like, you know, and this is like pre-Zoom really being a technology, but she was like, you know, people ask me, will you live stream it? And she was like, you know, she's like, I'm a power chair user. I face significant access barriers to getting places. I understand how challenging it is to get to the theater. And she's like, and yet this is like a sacred space once every couple years. She's like, that when disabled people are able to safely be together, it is holy, right? And there's magic that happens. And she's like, I want to work to support that. And she's like, you know, I think if we live streamed it, nobody would show up, because of course your bed's going to be more comfortable than Bart, you know? And that's real. And so I want us to keep exploring if there are ways, especially locally, that we can gather in safe ways. And there are some things I've seen, like another storybook store, which is a politically progressive woman of color led store in Toronto. Anju, who's been doing events in Toronto for God, like probably close to 30 years, maybe 25. She, when I was talking about what kind of events are you doing virtual? She's like, you know, during the summer months, there's an event space, the Witchwood Barns, that is basically outdoors. Like it's like a barn, but like it only has like 2 walls. And she's like, yeah, everyone's masked. We space everybody. There are these huge barn doors that are open. And, you know, we ask people to take care of each other. And I was like, well, that could be all right. You know, and she's like, and it's wheelchair accessible and the bathrooms are gender neutral and da da da. And I was like, okay, I'm listening. You know, that's possible. But, and that wasn't even that hard. You know, she just was like, yeah, no one, I mean, I think, she's like, the bookstore's small. Like no one really enjoyed cramming in there. I mean, I'm putting words in her mouth, but like it was a small space that wasn't ideal, let alone accessible for events before the pandemic. And now it's really not, you know, you got 25 people in there. So I'm just like, oh, you found this new way of doing it. Okay. You know, and I mean, I just hear about like, you know, with some queer and trans punk communities where people are like, yeah, we just had generator shows outside with masks on, you know, by the river. And it was beautiful. And we kept each other safe. Or the ways that during the rebellions in 2020, you know, I'm just thinking about the CHOP, you know, the zone in Seattle where I used to live. It took over 10 square blocks and a police precinct. And everyone, it was like hundreds of people masked outside, not getting each other sick. You could do that. And, you know, I just want to say, like, there's going to be another pandemic. There's going to be a lot of pandemics. And what we need to keep safe, it might not be masks, the next one that comes around. It might be something else. I also, last thing, and then I'll shut up. I put 2 links in chat for 2 different calls that are out of this kind of disabled creativity. The first is by a coalition of disabled queers in Chicago, really speaking to event coordinators and pride coordinators, being like, we have these asks of you. If you are going to do things in person, do it this way. And then the second is called let me see, well, I cut it off, but it's like Neglect and Eugenics in a Pandemic, and it's by Hannah Harris Sutro in Montreal, where she really looks back at AIDS, and she's like, you know, in public sex communities, in queer communities in the 80s, like the Catacombs, which was like a public sex venue where gay men and some lesbians were really into fisting, as soon as AIDS became a thing, like they pivoted and they were like, okay, we're going to cleanse the space. We're going to put out latex gloves. We're going to do all this stuff. And she's like, we can come from a politic of wanting to, our queer elders and to stay alive and for everyone to be able to grow to elderhood, right? In a pandemic. And she's like, and that goes back to like, what's the space of love and action that we do? So yeah, do that. Don't do some basic bullshit that's about a death cult.
Yes, I have so much yes in my spirit with this conversation. Thank you all for being here. So I have a last question. What's on your wish list for integrating disability justice more fully into the poetry world? What would you recommend as one step towards what you're dreaming of?
This is Naomi. I think we've touched on so much, so I'll keep this brief. Like all of what, I'm just gonna bring in all of what we've said already to answer this question. But a couple of things that really come up for me are around that disability has so much wisdom that is often overlooked with other subject matter. And we live our lives in ways where we have to be creative all the time. And so can bring some really interesting thinking to subjects like, you know, violence, climate change, sex, like all these different, you know, anything you can think of, disability brings like a really unique lens to that. And we're, disability is so diverse too. So there's a lot to pull from with all those things. So having conversations and invitations to talk about things beyond just disability or at the intersection of disability and X topic would be amazing. And the second thing that I just really, this is my dream, is that folks with intellectual disabilities be taken as legit poets. I am so sick of folks with intellectual disabilities being really diminished and discounted within poetry world. And so that to me is that's a dream I hold in my heart, something I'm leveraging in my own space and working towards locally. So yeah, those are some dreams for me.
This is Meg. I love that, Naomi. I love this conversation. One thing that's on my mind is getting rid of the, how do I want to say this? We should be done with rigor. That's what I want to say. We should be done with rigor. Socialized and academic understandings of difficulty and precision and perfection are boring and ableist, and I don't care about them, and I don't think you should either. And I think that when we don't prioritize them and we don't spend our time having conversations about, you know, what does and doesn't fit into a particular box, or what does and doesn't satisfy a particular form, exactly as the dead white men who established it would like, I think that we might be open to so many more things. And I guess really what I'm saying is you're missing out on so much. That's what I wish to say to, I don't really even know who I'm speaking to in this moment, the poetry world, hello world of poets, you're missing out in so many ways, not just in ways that Naomi's drawing attention to, but just, right, like we are so limited by language, we're so limited by our conceptions of excellence and rigor, and using age as a barometer for excellence and success, and you know, moving toward capitalist understandings of what it means to be good. Forget all that shit. That's what I hope. I hope we forget all of it. That's on my wish list. Was that the question? I have a long wish list, but that's at the top.
This is Leah. I love you so much. I will always tell this story. I've loved you since my car was an impound and you were like, I have $100. I don't really know you, but we both go to the same school. It's fucked up. And I was like, thanks. I don't have any money. It's 2008. You know, like, yeah, I mean, this is great. Cause I was like, well, and capitalism. And then I was like, oh, that's not really like, you know, I mean, I could, and there's things that are like more like practical or whatever, but like that are real, that are, that will change things. Like, I'm really proud that my publisher at Arsenal Pulp has access, like they, not just for the Crip writers, they're like, if, you know, for any of our writers, if you're going to book us, we have access requirements, you know, because they're like, we're going to pull this. And I'm like, thank you, you know, and it means that they're like, okay, so, you know, in Canada, a lot of bookstores don't have funding the way some US bookstores do for ASL and CART. So we are working with some of like the literary festivals that are kind of swoosh and uptight, but they've got in-house stuff. They've got more funding. And I'm like, you know what? Great. Like, yeah, let's fuck it up. It's great. I mean, but honestly, I'm just like, yeah, I want an end. I want the revolution. I want the end to capitalism, because then everything would be better and there wouldn't be any money and we'd be in the Star Trek Disability Justice universe where there just is, yeah, don't get me started because I will, but you know, where there's no money but enough food and access for everybody, and the access is really creative and as hot as Kayla Dettner's eyepiece in Star Trek Discovery. Yeah, I said it. I had to go there a little bit. My fandom is really big. And I guess, like, I want us to just keep turning towards each other. I mean, I guess this is the thing, like, my strategy often, like, I also get called in to be like, tell us how to DJ, tell us how to access. Oh, the conference is in 24 hours. Can you fix it? And, you know, I'm enough of a fucking bitter old bitch now that I can be like, no, I don't do that. And then I'm just like, okay, hi, but my friend who is on the system, I'm like, you really need that 500? Like, go for it, you know, or whatever, or like, ask for more, whatever you can do without a clawback. But I really don't have a lot of hope for, like, you know, the poetry community of the, you know, the abled and the hearing and the normative. But I do want, I just really think that, like, our power is in turning towards each other as disabled, deaf, cognitively, intellectually disabled, neuro weird people, to be like, let's study each other, like, let's learn from each other, let's set up our open mics and our writing circles and our zines and our, you know, performance spaces in this friend's accessible garage, you know, and stuff. And if we can do it big and we can expropriate that money and do something huge, do it. And also, I think there's something really important that DJs, not just in like the big funded spaces, that it's people who are like, yeah, it's my small town and it's my gathering that I have on Zoom, you know, or that I have in the backyard. That's me building community. That's really important. It's really important. That's also against fuck rigor, you know? God, I mean, you know, we're all on the money machine and we're surviving it the ways we can, you know? So, but it's complicated because, like, it's like, yes, I want there to be disability justice sections in every bookstore. And no, I don't want it to be that just some of us who are fancy and legible and considered smart, you know, and light-skinned and ambulatory get it and everybody else doesn't, you know, because they're too raw. Like, I don't want that. I guess I just want siblinghood and kinship to continue to be our organizing principle. Ah. Because that's what's kept us alive so far. It's not, and as we continue, they are going to offer some of us, hey, come on, be the token, you know, be the exception. You just have to leave everyone else behind and you have to water it down. And I mean, I think in some ways our lack of legibility and the complete disinterest of the abled in the hearing has both been fucked up, and it's been what saved us, because we've all been like, fuck you, you don't care anyway, I'm just gonna like be real. And I do think that it's like any movement, as things progress, they're like, oh, some of you can be on the boat if you just, you know, liberalize. So I don't want that. I don't want that. I do want my student loan debt forgiven, and I want everyone else's to be forgiven. Especially because Mills College doesn't exist anymore. So I'm like, I owe $110,000 to an art institution that's not real. And I'm just like, God, you know, yeah, that. Oh, and that story is what, oh, last thing, sorry. I just, yeah, I'm an autistic long talker and I'm trying to balance it out with not dominating. But I will say, you know, I didn't have a really creative last 2 years, and I don't think a lot of us did, because it was just emergency and death. But often something I've been sitting with is like, we are all in a huge amount of grief. And I do think that disabled, deaf, neurodivergent art is going to be part of what saves us, because it is a place where we can go with this like huge scream, gaping maw of not just grief, but anger and complete batshit shit we've been through, and story and memory. And that's going to be what holds us, if anything does. So that's why art's important. That's why we're important. That one. Okay, I'll shut up now.
Thank you all. This is Camisha. Ooh, feel so full and so happy to have you all in this space answering these questions. I wish we could talk all night. But I know we have promised that this event will end at 8 o'clock. So we're going to pivot now, and each of the poets have selected a poem that they would like to share. And we're going to give them an opportunity to share that poem, beginning with Meg Day.
This is Meg. The poem that I'm going to be reading is called It Must Still Be Summer, and it's after a line by Nikki Finney. Nikki Finney is a writer, a Black writer, Black lesbian writer, who changed my life, but also who helped me better understand my own confluence of identities, and to find joy in the hardness of deafness. So that poem begins here. It must still be summer, because the tent goes up easy in the bluegrass, and we loiter past sundown without sleeves. The sunset, one thing we can watch that won't require captioning and isn't each other. What did you say then? Hand cupped to my ear, as if it would send more than winter across my arm. What did I believe I knew of language in that moment before everything about me became true? I followed you into the dark like a vowel, a train disappearing into a tunnel at the end of a light. It's night in the tent, and my eyes can't help but deny my ears. So it's my hands that go dowsing for sound. The push broom sweep of our sleeping bags and the hourglass sand of their slow unzip. I catch your lip in the gold leaf glare of your neighbor's third shift headlights, wet road rumble in my hips and yellow cymbal flashbang through your hair. I don't care how it happened, only that it did. 1 minute, an eternity, with you tracing the bones in my face with your read-along finger, mouthing me out, quiet, common mispronunciation I still let slide between my thighs at the right octave. Another, and you are all wicker, flank, soft muzzle in my palm. What makes a woman who is barely a woman move like this? What secret grammar do you know? I feed apple fingers past eager lips smacking on 13 plus one, the heat of you sucking at the M of my name sign, my Girl Scout promise. What part of your body isn't saying my name? Say it again. Say it louder. This is the last night of my life when hands remain only one kind of mouth. Whose tongue is this, and where did you learn it? What made you invent a new chord, then made me play it like a siren for a three-alarm fire, summon new gods with their good names hot at the reed of my jaw like some kind of symphony disarmed of melody? All these questions and the answer right there at the end of my arm.
Thank you, Meg. This is Camisha. Next up, we have Naomi.
Whew. This is Naomi, just soaking that magic in. So my poem actually was part of, I was a finalist for this dance company, Sid Perlman Dance in California. Had a contest and they were looking for poems to create dance to, and then they were going to film it, or they did film it, and then it was an art installation at Santa Cruz Museum of Art and History this year. And I thought one of the things I think was amazing is the five finalists, at least three of them that I know for sure were disabled, and it wasn't necessarily geared towards disabled folks, but the theme of the show was homebody. So this is my poem. Majestic, disabled, queer, people of color elders, instruct how to dance in the struggle. Drag that chair out to the dance floor, find your own damn beat, the one that brings chin, shoulders, hips, wrists alive. With palms open, grasp air abundant from sky, pull down into lungs, embrace, sit, sway, take a minute. Before arms emboldened, cross to caress chest, spirit, soul. The lyrics might steam with desire, cumbia would done me wrong, but what they really say is when there is struggle, there also must be a tending of joy. How do we tend joy? There is no secret. You can't just with the power of your mind actually will things to change. Yet, every ancestor who came before seasoned that shoulder pump and jut with optimism. Fingers will always trace where you end and the world begins. The mistake is to not understand movement is sensual love, exalted joy, a return to the singular pain of being alive. Movement smells like salty sweat sobaco, the cataclysmic sulfur of creation, blessed juniper smoke, drenching space from bundle lit. Girl, you can't pound the floor with a clenched jaw. You gotta open that mouth to sing, to determine the taste, to chew up and spit out, digest truth through body to soil. It all goes back to the soil. With those hands waving up, reach out, touch what lives at your side, your other side, shimmy weight from hip to hip, to balance, constitute ground. Own those spasmic, rhythmic vibrations to unearth the foundation underneath which was tolerated before, destabilize the unexpected. Endure surprise, the soft punch to the gut, pause in the middle of everything and rest. Then return fist to center, rib cage, breast. Twirl heart knee between fingers, wrist rotate to catch the stem, pull it up towards light with a swing, thrust, release. Thank you.
This is Camisha. Thank you, Naomi. Last up, we have Leah.
Hey, this is Leah, and this is called How We Made It. We didn't. We didn't break down your door. Your mom flew north. We set up an altar by your ICU bed, asked the nurse to put a rebozo on your chest, prayed. B stole me a giant bottle of Costco bourbon for Christmas 2020, slipped it in the ass of his power chair. Nobody wants to look in the ass of a fat man in a wheelchair, kid. Happy solstice. I poured out most of it that year, so many prayers, and I sipped the rest. We were terrified. We didn't know how to do this. I watched 14 seasons of ER so I could live in a fantasy world where poor disabled people are loved and cared for well by doctors. We organized your funeral in 3 days. We cried afterwards separately. You sent me one of her shawls. I asked you for the mug I sent her for the last Christmas she had. It arrived here in 3 days. I planted onions and green seeds and watered them and moved them to sunlight. We had boxes of meat and cabbages at Estelita's library, boxes of masks and lentils outside of the state. The three of us sat in the abandoned playground and ate tacos. I cried when I went back to the grocery store after 9 months. I cried when I went to the library. I walked the same damn 10 to 15 minute walk as many days as I remembered, looked around and pulled my mask off when nobody was there. We primal screamed in the closet. I sent you groceries. You sent me flowers. You sent me a 9-layer gluten-free Southern pound cake the day after she died without a note. I sent Seattle coffee. We texted, touched fingers. You took over the radio station. We kept each other from dying. We spoke for the dead. Some of us we couldn't keep. You died. We thought that we had more time. We organized your funeral in 3 days. Thanks.
This is Camisha. Thanks to all the poets. I am so grateful for tonight's gathering. There is just nothing like gathering with Kripkin. And as Meg Day mentioned earlier, you know, once you have experienced the sort of gathering that centers disabled lives, like, why would you ever want anything else? Like, I haven't been a part of some of the gatherings that the other poets have mentioned, but I have been a part of I Want to Be With You Everywhere. And I know walking into that space and not having to ask for accommodations, to simply have been anticipated and expected and wanted. It's just a whole different level of hospitality and love and care. And it is something that I hope all events take into the heart of them. Why would you want to offer any kind of event that makes someone feel like they're not wanted? That's what it comes down to. So much gratitude to all the poets for your fierceness and honesty and activism and love and care in the world. You all keep me inspired and pushing to keep doing my best to make things better in some small way in my little corner of the world. Thanks to everybody who tuned in. I appreciate everybody, all your little comments in the chat. I have noticed them. Thank you for letting us know how things have moved you. Thank you to our captioner, Max, our interpreter, Emily, to the team here at Split This Rock working behind the scenes to cover logistics, Chelsea and Alexandria. Please support these poets, buy their books, hire them for COVID safe and accessible engagements, pay them well. You can find their websites on our website, the events YouTube page, and our social media pages, and you can find out how to support them there. The video for this event will be posted soon to our YouTube channel once it's been accurately captioned. As I was preparing for the event, I came across one of the quotes in Care Work that really lingered with me, Leah's book, Care Work. So I'm going to just close by offering it. When I think about access, I think about love. I think about Crip solidarity, and solidarity between Crips and non-yet Crips is a powerful act of love, and I got your back. It's in big things, but it's also in the little things we do moment by moment to ensure that we all and all our individual bodies get to be present fiercely as we make change. Embedded in this is a giant paradigm shift. Our crip bodies aren't seen as liabilities, something that limits us and brings pity, or something to nobly transcend, because I'm just like you. Our crip bodies are gifts, brilliant, fierce, skilled, valuable, assets that teach us things that are relevant and vital to ourselves, our communities, our movements, the whole goddamn planet. Thank you all for being here. I wish you all the kind of love and care that can only be found, well, that I have experienced among crew. Take care, everybody.